Thank you for joining Auto Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and we will take you inside the auto industry like never before. And when I say we, I mean me and my very, very knowledgeable, manly panel today, located in the film strip below. All we need to do now is show some things hanging on the wall, and you'd be in the man cave. This is Auto Network Reports Man Cave. Now, we may have one lady showing up. She has something to do. Hopefully, Linda will join us because we're going to have a very, very interesting show today. We're going to talk about a lot of in-the-news topics. A lot's happening in the news. And we may as well start out with the journalists introducing themselves, talking a little bit about what they do, where they are, starting with Russ.
Hi, coming to you live from Greenville, South Carolina, I'm Russ Heaps, and I've been covering cars in the automotive industry for just about 30 years. I've done it in print newspapers, magazines. Now it's mostly on the internet, websites.com. I do a lot of work for autotrader.com and a lot of work for bankrate.com. And I also run a little website called GreenvilleInsider.com, a deeper dive into Greenville, South Carolina.
Ron.
Hi, Ron Moorhead, coming to you from Northern California. I'm the editor of AutoReviewsPlus.com, and I contribute to a number of magazines, newspaper columns, and websites. Just about done everything in the auto industry you could possibly do, from changing tires to oil to running dealerships. So. And working with the manufacturers, and now writing about them and photography, and joining this wonderful panel here, which I have for the 117th time, I think.
118.
118.
Okay, Greg.
Hi, I'm Greg Morrison. I'm owner and executive producer of Bumper to Bumper TV. We do weekly video reviews of cars and trends in the auto industry. We're based in Atlanta, Georgia, as you can see in our subterranean man cave offices. We are seen on AOL, YouTube, and a few other venues, including the Atlanta Voice newspaper. And one thing, Russ, you forgot to mention, is the latest part of what you do is Just Three Things, a very interesting take on three items or three issues that should be well-known, whether it's how to make a mojito or what's new in a car. Good work, Russ.
Thanks for mentioning it.
Frank.
Hello. It's Frank Washington. I'm based here in Detroit. Feels like we're in the deep south versus the Midwest. We've got temperatures that are going to be 90-plus degrees with humidity for the next 3 or 4 days. And I get to hear all these people complaining about the heat. It's like spend 6 years in Louisiana and then come talk to me. Anyway, I do a website as well as a column called AboutThatCar.com. I refrain from calling myself the editor because I don't pay me. So I just work on it. I'm currently writing a book about blacks in the auto industry. As Russ said, I've covered the auto industry in depth and detail in terms of trends, marketing, sales, just the business of the industry itself, and a lot of different things. Looking forward to a great conversation today. Thank you.
Great. Chris.
Hello, I'm Chris Lawrence. I have a company called Auto Academics. We are based in the Atlanta, Georgia area, and, I can understand that it is Georgia hot out here. The car was reading 99 degrees as I was coming back to my office this afternoon, so I'm with you. That heat is unbelievable right now. But back to what I do. I have a blog on autoacademics.net, and we also have a YouTube channel, which is just Auto Academics, where we do car reviews and just share a bit of the information that's out there in the automotive industry.
Great. Well, I'm sitting here in hot Charlotte, which happens to be stormy Charlotte right now. It's a downpour, a little bit of thunder, which means there is lightning around, so hopefully I won't lose my connection. I have a backup set up just in case I do. If I pop out for whatever reason, I'll try and get back in, guys, so you can keep it going. Talk a little bit about what are you driving this week. Russ.
Well, I'm good. Number one, I just want to mention, Chris, I had to look at it closely when you were introducing yourself, and I saw that contraption that's sort of to your right there, and at first glance I thought it was a mirror, and I thought, wow, he's sitting there with a mirror looking at himself while he's talking, but obviously it's a windscreen for a microphone, but yeah, I was a little concerned there. I'm not going to talk about what I'm currently driving because I've got a Hyundai Elantra, which is a terrific car, but we've talked about it a couple of times before. So what I'll mention is I happened to, last week I was at the media event for the 2017 Honda Accord Hybrid, and they skipped 2016 for the car because they were moving production from the Marysville, Ohio plant over to somewhere in Japan. So that took them about a year or so, but now they're producing it. So I'll just give you a quick rundown of it. A couple of things that you should know, and I'm going to look at my cheat sheet here a little bit. But two things in terms of mid-size hybrids. And number one, it's got the highest horsepower of any of those cars, like the Ford Fusion hybrid and the Hyundai Sonata hybrid and the Chevy Malibu hybrid at 212 horsepower. It's also got the best city fuel economy at 49 miles per gallon. So those are kind of the two big things to talk about. Starting price is $29,605. The car that we drove last week was the Touring model, which is the top of the three models. It retails for $35,955. And for that money, you get what is basically a loaded car. But even the $29,000 version comes with Honda Sensing, which is all of their autonomous vehicle kind of things, the lane holding and the front collision mitigation and all of those things. So that's all included even in the $29,000 version. I'm not a big fan of hybrids. I just don't think it. The mileage difference, you can get some cars with some pretty good mileage without paying the extra premium for the hybrid system, but I have to tell you, this was a lot of fun to drive, and the one thing that my driving partner and I noticed, that usually when you drive a hybrid and you brake, you can feel the drag on the braking system because it's regenerative braking, that the hybrid system is sucking energy off the brakes and putting it back in the battery. Honda has come up with some way to eliminate that sensation. So when you brake in this car, it feels like you're braking in the normal Accord, and I think that's something worth talking about.
Great. Ron, what are you driving this week?
I have to hit my mic there. I'm driving an NV3500 Nissan cargo van, not something that we generally get to test. But I'm amazed at how quiet it is, even though it doesn't have a lot of insulation, and how nice it is to drive. It's comfortable, believe it or not. There's not much in the back, but lots of cargo room. You could put a 10-foot by 4.5-foot piece of whatever on the floor, and nice room. This is a hippie van for the modern day age. You know, a big V8 engine, runs about $30,000 base. And I'm sure, in fact, I've seen them a lot out there. It makes you feel like a UPS driver.
Small business van.
I just want to pitch in there that I had the passenger version of that in Nashville, I don't know, 2 or 3 months ago. A bunch of fraternity brothers of mine and I got together and did a little reunion thing, and Nissan was nice enough to supply the van for us there so we could all motor around together, and I was pretty impressed with it. I was surprised at how drivable it is, And it's a fairly big vehicle, but it's still very manageable. And I liked it a lot.
On a one-ton chassis, too. Yeah, it was pretty comfortable.
Right. Greg?
Well, Russ was waxing eloquently about the Honda Accord Hybrid. This week I'm driving a Honda Accord sedan, the Sport Edition. And even at this level, at 26,900, this vehicle comes with the Honda Sensing suite of lane keep assist, you know, collision mitigation and so forth. It's a four-cylinder engine. It's a mid-sized car with plenty of interior room. Had a lot of fun with it, averaged about 30 miles to the gallon. And it's one of those cars that if you want a Honda Accord with a little bit of style and without laying out a whole bunch of cash, this may be one you really want to look at. Interior noise was spot-on quiet, and while you didn't have leather seats, it was comfortable enough that you don't mind driving this around for 5 to 6 years.
Great. Frank?
Hi. I just got out of a Buick, and forgive me, I don't know how to pronounce it. Is it Cascada or Cascada? The convertible.
So you went topless in Detroit.
I did, and I got away with it. Nobody arrested me. But I was it's kind of like is the jar half full or is it half empty? It's a great looking car, because people around here are car aficionados, and any number of people did ask me what it was in an admiring tone. I thought the car handled well. It was solid on the road. The thing that not so much concerned me, but it had a four-cylinder turbocharged engine that made 200 horsepower. Normally, an engine that particular engine would give a car some spunk and some pep, maybe even make it really quick. The Cascada wasn't. It was peppy, but I thought the engine could have been. They could have had a more engine in the car, because years and years ago I discovered that a convertible is actually heavier than a comparably sized sedan, because they have to use heavy grade steel because it doesn't have a top. In terms of center gravity and all of this, and the Cascada actually weighs almost 4,000 pounds. And I thought that was a lot of weight. I thought that engine moved it sharply. You didn't feel the engine straining and so on and so forth. But I think that car could actually use a V6 with a little bit more power, or a four-cylinder with more power. Other than that, I thought it was a great car.
Great. Chris?
Sorry. All right. Well, first, to piggyback on that, the Cascada. I do believe that's how they say it now. I remember I did a little bit of a walk around on that car a year and a half ago at the Atlanta Auto Show when GM was first presenting it there, and it's at least nice to see that it has finally made it into the fleet as well as the market, and we'll see how that car is. But to piggyback on Russ with the Honda Accord Hybrid, that was something I noticed as well, not on the Accord, but on another vehicle where the braking, it doesn't feel like a hybrid or electric vehicle's braking anymore. Manufacturers are starting to get the hang of the feel, and being able to get that regenerative braking where it's still functional, but it doesn't give you, it's not as grabby as it used to be with the earlier cars. So, now that I've gotten all that out of the way, my vehicle this week is the Infiniti QX60, aka the JX35, and I'm proud to say that I've been learning the nomenclature now a little bit better for Infiniti's vehicles. I'm starting to make the connections a little bit better now in their range, and so QX60 is actually it does make a little bit more sense to me now that I've been seeing it more. And that vehicle, it's a large crossover vehicle. It's a 3-row, 7-passenger vehicle. Great for families. The one that I'm testing is pretty much loaded. So it's got the theater package and all of the safety technology and everything else in it. And although I've only been driving it for a couple of days right now, it's been a nice vehicle. It's been averaging 20 plus miles at a gallon without trying. And, you know, that can be rather impressive for a vehicle of that size that can actually seat adults in the third row if you slide the second row up a little bit. So it's been a very functional vehicle. It's nicely styled. It drives nice. It has decent power also, so you're getting that kind of fuel economy with the power. And, my wife and I have been following this vehicle for many years. We were considering purchasing one of those because we liked the functionality of it for families, especially when you've got car seats and stuff like that. And, you know, this was back when it was the JX35. And, you know, it still is a nice vehicle. So that's what I've been working with this week. The price is $58,845. Little pricey, but again, this one's pretty loaded as well. And you can get them starting off in the mid-40s. So not too bad of a vehicle.
Great. Well, I'm out of rotation this week, so there is no first thoughts car. Moving right along, we have picked up a new newspaper that is featuring Auto Network reports and my detailed walk around that I do of the new cars that I have access to pretty much every week, and that is the Chicago Crusader. We're also you can find us on the website of the Washington Informer, the West Side Gazette, the Wilmington Journal, and the Dallas Weekly. So I want to welcome the Chicago Crusader to the list. Hopefully our videos will help you pick up some automotive advertising. That's the whole purpose and the end goal of doing all of this, to get you to carry some very, very unique content. Nowhere else in the world will you find so many good-looking men located in one room. Yeah, we should all look around. But anyway, moving right along, it seems like Takata has struck again. Ladies and gentlemen, as I keep saying, it probably won't go away. The airbag igniter or inflator situation is still around 60 million. It is dropping a little bit because some of the cars are being repaired. Unfortunately, looks like, who is it? General Motors may add another 4.3 million vehicles to the recall list because of the Takata airbag situation. As I've said, check your VIN number on the government website. You can go to NHTSA.gov. You should be able to enter your VIN number to see if your car is under any type of recall, regardless of what it is. Please make an appointment, get it fixed, protect you, your family, and other people on the road. Volkswagen, it's interesting, and I don't understand this one, but maybe you all have heard about it and you can explain it to me. Volkswagen has recalled and repaired, and they have some repaired cars, and the repaired cars still will not be compliant. And they're going to let them repair them, put them on the road. They will still be emitting more emissions than they should. They're not going to meet the emissions test. But it seems like Volkswagen has decided, okay, if I can dump some billions of dollars in some of these clean air programs, maybe we can skate through this. And it looks like that's what they're doing. They have agreed to dump several million dollars into some environmental programs. So they're letting Volkswagen repair these cars, put them on the road, and they still do not meet the emission standards. This is one we need to talk about, guys. Your thoughts?
Well, my question is okay, they go into the shop, they get a manufacturer's repair, it still doesn't meet emission standards. Are the emission standards going to be adjusted for the repaired vehicles, saying that, hey, they made a real good effort, but just didn't quite hit the mark? And, you know, I'm just thinking in terms of resale value of these cars down the line.
Don't know. like I said, this one is a little confusing to me.
I'm always suspicious of the federal government, and I know it's a conspiracy theory kind of thing, but
live in California.
Yeah, I know. Well, you've got double-barreled stuff going on there, but I don't know how much of this flailing around that the federal government's doing over this is just sort of more about soaking some corporation and squeezing some money out of them than it is really something altruistic and, oh my gosh, we've got to, you know, save the environment. So it may be, I haven't read the story, so I don't have a clue what the mindset is here or what the thinking is or but obviously if they're able to put these cars back out on the street without them meeting the standards that this whole thing started over to begin with, the federal government has to be in there somewhere going, yeah, go ahead, do it. Right? Am I right or wrong?
Right.
So it makes little or no sense to me, except this was just another opportunity for the feds to hold up a company.
Well, before we get any more comments on this one, listen to this one from the federal government about the Takata airbags. Mercedes-Benz, the Sprinter, and Ferrari models, they know have faulty airbags. They're going to let them sell them because the bags have not been subject to high humidity long enough, so they know they're going to be on the recall list in 2018. Now,
Are you saying the airbags in my Ferrari are bad?
Yes.
Oh, man.
Or they will be by 2018.
Yeah, 2018. They're not bad now. They will be in 2018. Yeah.
If you're living in an area with high humidity like Florida, Russ.
So don't take the car down to South Florida.
The I've got one of my clients wants me to do a story on these future recalls. Particularly since Toyota, the feds have already told Toyota that they've got to somehow label these cars or disclose the cars that are going to get recalled in 2018 but are currently being sold. They've got to somehow mark those. But if you get on the site, on the Fed site, about the airbag thing, they don't have a list of what's coming in 2018. So, all they have is, the more information will be coming. But either they know or they don't know. Either they have a list or they don't have a list. I don't get what the issue is, what the problem is. But I'm under the impression that there are a bunch of cars that still haven't been recalled that are going to be recalled in the future. And the feds know it.
And
the car companies know it. But we don't know it.
Other than some Mercedes, some Sprinter vans, and Ferraris that they do know about.
Along with a bunch of Toyotas and Lexus.
Right.
If I could inject just a minute here, one of the things that, the two instances that you noted make no sense.
Right.
Okay. Even for the federal government, they make no sense. One of the things that has not been factored in is, in a way, it sounds to me, like reading between the lines, the feds, which is basically the safety organization, and all that. They're saying we're tired. Number one. Number two, we're not going to be here next year. Because we look at, at a very minimum, we're looking at a change of administrations. No matter who wins the presidential election, one thing is sure, Barack Obama will not be there for a third term. So therefore, his administration is changing, and it wouldn't surprise me that in some instances, what they're saying is, let the next guys take care of it.
Could be.
kicking it down the road, much like Congress has done, but that's a whole other set of issues.
Like they said around here, when the city got up to like 60% of the streetlights not working, it wasn't like they all stopped working one night, you know, over the decade, literally years and years and years, which amounted to decades. It was like kicking the can down the road, as Dave Bing said when he was mayor of Detroit, and this sounds like the same thing, kicking the can down the road and let somebody else handle it.
Right. On a lighter note, moving. Who was that that wanted to say something?
Well, I was just trying to figure what that does for insurance and safety 5 years from now if you're deferring recalls on vehicles and you know that, you know, some of them got some serious issues. That doesn't give me a lot of confidence as a consumer who's thinking about walking into a dealership and plunking down $25,000 to $35,000 for a vehicle, worried about, will this thing be another one that's already, they know is going to be recalled and I'm stuck with it now?
Why, I don't understand why it's a future recall. If they know the problem exists right now, why aren't they recalling them right now?
I just told you with the Mercedes, the Sprinter, and the Ferrari, they have not been in a high humidity area long enough to be subject to the recall.
So they're saying by then the humidity levels will be high enough
to kill somebody.
Right. Exactly.
There'll be enough replacement parts to do it.
Yeah. On a lighter note, I know most of you know John Krafcek, and he has moved on to the head of the Google Autonomous Car Program. And I don't know whether this is a commercial that they're going to have out or what, but I saw a video, and John was driving one of the autonomous cars, and in the video was his 97-year-old mother talking to him about driverless cars, talking about, what do I do? Do I talk to this thing? Does it who's driving this? Are you driving this, John? But it was a nice little piece, and a lot of people are thinking the same questions that she was asking John. But I thought it was an interesting piece, and surprisingly that they put his mother, who, like I said, who's 97 years old, in this video piece about Google autonomous cars. So, but let's get into talking a little bit about what I had as the topic of the day. I ran across this, and I found it interesting that Mazda, as you know, has SkyActiv, and that's a lot of technology in cars, and it does a lot of things. I don't even know whether Mazda knows exactly all the things that SkyActiv does, because I think Ron was there, and he asked him a question about a couple of things and didn't get a good explanation. But it seems as though Mazda has a very hard time trying to explain their driver assistance program that they call VG, as in George Vectoring, and it has to do with steering in and out of curves, throttling the engine, changing this, you know, being able to determine what the driver is doing with the steering wheel, also involved braking, the engine's torque. So I thought I was going to have both of my ex-race car drivers on here. Maybe they could explain in more simpler terms than what Mazda tried to do as to what this G-vectoring does. So I asked Ron to take a look at it. Ron used to race cars, and I thought Linda was going to be on, and Linda used to race cars. Ron, give us a quick explanation or your interpretation of what Mazda's G-vectoring is.
From all the material that I've been able to peruse with Mazda, G-vectoring is essentially a software part of their program for their SkyActiv. And what it does is it senses steering angle, the wheels, front wheels, steering angle, if you steer into a curve or make an adjustment or a quick adjustment on the highway when you're driving straight, say in an emergency situation. What it does is it reduces torque ever so slightly, just minor reduce in torque. What it does by doing that, it puts about 2 to 10 pounds of pressure on the outside wheel tire. So it gives that a little more grip. Essentially, in race car terms, it gives oversteer, but so minutely that the driver or passengers will not feel it. And what Mazda says is this reduces the impact on passenger comfort, driver ability to go smoothly into a turn, and out of a turn as you correct back. So basically, it makes the vehicle more comfortable for the person and gives the driver, without the driver knowing, a better input into the turn. So that's about as simple as I can get. Software, steering angle reduces torque on the engine, puts a little more pressure on that outside front wheel so that the vehicle is turning smoother than it would normally.
In layman's English, it means less pucker factor on your backside.
Yeah, but it comes into play even at slow speeds, and more importantly, they say at 30 kilometers to 50 kilometers is what I've been reading anyway.
And it's one of the purposes is to reduce driver stress and fatigue.
Correct.
Right. So if you've been on the track, which most of us have, probably all of us, and you know you go into a turn, the first thing you want to do, obviously you turn the steering wheel just a little bit, you brake some, which causes the front of the car to kind of dive a little bit forward. And when you're coming out of the turn, you do just, you steer the car just a little bit, and you normally will accelerate. Most of us will probably accelerate, or I know I do, when I'm in the turn and want to come flying out of the turn like a slingshot. And I'm sure that's not the proper way to do it. But what happens is the car pretty much takes over, like Ron said, so subtle that you think that you're one of the best drivers out there on the track.
Okay, a little race car tutoring here. You never do inputs into the accelerator or brake when you're turning the wheels.
Right.
So what Mazda's saying is just as you start thinking about turning the wheels, the car goes, oh, okay, he's turning or she's turning, and I'm going to help them out.
Ah, there's Linda. Linda, welcome.
Hey, how are you guys today?
You popped in just in time.
Yeah. We're talking
about Mazda G Vectoring, driving curves. Why don't you quickly tell us who you are, where you are, and we'll keep right along within the news.
Okay, my name is Linda Sharp, and I've been in the automotive journalism business now for over 2 decades. Have written for a variety of newspapers. Had a syndicated column on the New York Times and Cox Wire Services. Have written for major magazines around the country. Produce a blog, sharpdriver.com. I am located in the very sultry Blue Ridge Mountains of North Carolina today. I don't know who sent us the heat, but y'all can have it back. We don't like it.
I have heat and rain right now, so I can feel your pain.
Yeah, heat and humidity, yuck.
Linda, we were talking about, and I sent you an email. I don't know whether you had an opportunity to take a look at it, but I wanted you to kind of read up on Mazda's G-Vectoring, and if you didn't, that's okay. And we were talking. Go ahead.
I looked at it briefly, and it appears to me that through the use of computers, they are doing for the driver what a well-trained driver would hope they could accomplish. A vehicle has 100% straight-line grip. A vehicle doesn't have 100% turning grip. So as soon as you turn the wheels, you start to lose grip. Now, if you have 100% acceleration in a straight line, but when you're turning the wheels, you can't use 100%. And sometimes it's really hard to get people to believe that, you know, if you want the car to do two things at one time, you actually have to reduce the input. And I noticed that one of the things that it does, the G-Vectoring, is it reduces the throttle input. So that's a good thing because you're asking it to turn and you're asking it to accelerate. And also, Miata, it's a rear-wheel drive car. So with the rear-wheel drive car, when you accelerate really hard, you're taking weight off the front wheel, so it also balances the weight in the vehicle, because you have to have a certain amount of downforce on that wheel in order for the tire to grip effectively. Now, on a front-wheel drive car, all the weight is in the front of the car. So if you're asking a front-wheel drive car that has all the weight in the front and you're asking it to accelerate and turn, it's inherent that most front-wheel drive cars understeer or push, whichever term you prefer. So by adjusting the weight balance of the car, it helps to accomplish the goal you're trying to reach. And as I understand it, it does this so subtly that the driver will never be aware that it's being helped. They'll just think, hey, I'm really good at this.
Why do you think Mazda is having such a hard time getting people to understand this or explain this to people?
Partially because they don't understand it. I mean, I don't want to speak for Mazda because they're great folks. They really are trying to do some great things with electronics. However, I think they don't. It's hard to explain to the lay person what this does and how it equates to making the vehicle drive smoother. That's my take, I guess.
And you know, it wouldn't surprise me is that what they're trying to do is explain the technology. They're so enraptured with their own technology that they want to explain it. And generally speaking, to the buying public, you can't explain technology. Basically, you say something like, it makes turning easier. it's really that simple. Is that what it? That's what it does. It makes turning easier in the sense of at speed, gives you more control of the car. Some such as that. When you start talking about vectoring, when you start telling the buying public about vectoring, you've lost them with that one word, because I remember doing the story on Mannheim, and they had just put in these computers, and every office I went into, it was like these guys were like data drunk. You know, they'd sit there in front of these screens, and they'd say this and say that. They were all enraptured with their new computers and the new programs that when I walked out, I had no idea what they were talking about.
Frank is right. There's lots of times between engineers and the general public, it just gets lost in translation. Many, many years ago, I worked in the engineering department as only a clerk, not an engineer, y'all, at AT&T. And these guys would come up with these things that they thought they were just magnificent ideas. And they would send them out to the manufacturing floor, and they didn't work at all. You know, it looked really good on paper back then, but it just did not work in reality. Now, I'm not saying the vector doesn't work. Obviously, it does work. But, most people are not that astute of a driver that they're going to even perceive the need for this. Now, the people that are, they're going to club races and stuff like that, they might see a benefit to this, but it's my understanding from what I read that this is very, very subtle input. But Mazda, to their credit, they've always been known as car guy company. You know, they're real driving enthusiasts. So, I totally understand that they're trying to make the driving experience as good as they possibly can. But I think Frank is right that most public would go, yeah, so, sounds good, but what does it really do for me? If I can't feel it, why do I need it? It really will serve a benefit to them, especially in high-speed corners and things like that where you rarely get in trouble in low-speed corners. But in high-speed corners, it would definitely be a benefit because most people aren't smart enough to just throttle back a little bit in a high-speed corner. Everybody wants big fixes, and cars typically don't want big fixes. They want little fixes.
And I think that's why they're using the term G-vectoring to describe it as opposed to it helps you turn. Because like you were saying, most people are like, well, I don't need it to help me turn. I'm a good driver or whatever it is. But terms like G-vectoring sound cool. So even if they can't really explain it, it's like, but it sounds cool. G-vectoring. Yeah.
Chris, I taught at Road Atlanta for 18 years, and in 18 years, I never had a student show up that didn't tell me they were a wonderful driver.
Exactly.
It sounds cool, and they still can't explain it. So they're spending all that extra money on trying to explain something that sounds cool. So.
Well, I guess my question is, how many other manufacturers have similar systems in their either front-wheel or all-wheel drive vehicles? And of that number, how many of their buyers really understand the capability of it? I mean, if you're buying something like a Porsche, yeah, you sort of expect that. But a Chevy Cruze?
Well, I think because of the size of Mazda, the size of the company, and their ad budget, they're trying to definitely distinguish themselves from the competition, and this is one way of doing it by using terminology like Sky Active and G Vectoring.
I think maybe they're trying to appeal to millennials because millennials love the latest technology, the latest gadget, the latest gizmo, and they're not going to admit that they don't understand what it is. They're just going to say, hey, man, I got this new car, and it's got G-Vectoring. It's really cool. It's like, so what is it? Oh, it's really cool. That's what it is.
You know, Crest sold a lot of toothpaste talking about stannous fluoride. Nobody in the world knows what the heck stannous fluoride is, and my understanding is it was just a made-up term. But they, boy, oh, boy, that was their advertising tag for probably 15 years.
Yeah. Well, we'll see what it does for Mazda sales. I haven't seen any numbers lately as to how well they're doing. And I think we were in the green room. It's not on all of their models yet, but it's something that they're going to add to all of their models in the future. Moving right along, this is something that Russ can identify with down there in Florida when he was in Florida. And I think he may have lost his fortune, but Porsche Design Tower, which is a tower that's being built in Sunny Isle, Florida, 20 billionaires have pooled their funds, and the owners can take an elevator to go up to their personal sky garage. So if you buy like a Porsche or a Lamborghini or you have your Rolls Royce, and they have three patented what they call deservators. You know, that's another term. What the heck is a deservator? And it's a glass drive-in elevator that owners can view their cars from their living room. And these units cost some like $6.2 million, and the penthouse is $32 million. And right now they have 20 billionaires. I'm sure somebody's going to bow out, Russ, so you can have one of those.
Man, oh man, you got to be like a 0.25 percenter to do that. Holy cow!
Now that's, you're talking about having too much money. You don't want to park your car in a regular garage. You have your own glass garage off from your living room.
So basically, it's a glass freight elevator.
Yeah. When I was younger, I used to have my Porsche engine in the living room while I was working on it. That was a long time ago.
So now, what is it again? It's one garage that houses your vehicle and you can put the camera.
No, it is a tower where you live. It's a tower where you live, but you have a glass. They have these three what they call desert. Elevators instead of elevators that take your car up to your living room, to your floor. So if you live on the fifth floor, it takes it up to the fifth floor.
Oh, this is a residential tower.
Yes, this is a residential tower, and you park your car in your glass garage off from your living area so you can literally see your car. You don't have to worry about parking it and having a guard or something like that.
Well, now, it may not be quite as crazy as it sounds. If I can bore you with a little story, I knew a guy. He was a doctor down in Savannah, and he had this vintage Ferrari that was worth, I don't know, how many millions of dollars, a whole bucket load. As a matter of fact, when the guy restored it, he brought it to him and wouldn't even let the doctor touch it. He delivered it to his house. And one day, his wife calls and said, well, I didn't know you sold the Ferrari. And the doctor says, what are you talking about? She said, well, the Ferrari's not in the garage. And he said, well, it was there this morning. Long story short, the builder who still had access to the house, got the car. They found it in Tampa, about to be loaded on a boat, and the only reason they found it was because some guy had always said to this doctor, if you ever sell this Ferrari, call me first. I'll buy it, regardless of what you're asking. Well, he saw him loading the car on a boat. So, you know, if you've got a car that's really, really, really valuable, and you want to keep a watchful eye on it, this might make sense, maybe. Plus, in Florida, if you're high up, probably the rust isn't going to get to it. But that said, Russ is right, you know, you're in the mino percent, you know, itty bitty micro percent of the 1% in order to justify this expense.
The other thing that I would say is, who living on the fifth floor is going to have that nice a car? Come on, you got to be on the 29th floor.
Of course, I hate to tell you, in these high rise buildings, the higher up you go, the more expensive the thing gets.
Yeah, like the penthouse.
I know that.
The penthouse is $32 million, Russ.
I know, that's what I'm saying. But who on the fifth floor could? Why would they have a nice car? They're on the fifth floor.
If all I could afford was the fifth floor.
They're all billionaires. Go ahead, Chris.
I was just saying, if all I could afford was the fifth floor, I might take it.
Yeah, because the rest of us would be in the basement down three or four floors.
The rest of us wouldn't even be in the neighborhood. We wouldn't even be on that aisle, on Sunny Isle.
I'm not going to lie. If I had the type of car to warrant something like that, as well as the money, obviously, to go with it, I would probably consider something like that. I'm nutty to that level, so I wouldn't mind trying out something like that.
Well, they, like I said, he found 20 billionaires with a B, the big B, and that's what they're doing on Sunny Isle. Auto Pacific's had their 2016, what are they calling it, their Ideal Vehicle Awards, and those are the vehicles that best meet the expectations of the owners. And the overall winner was Volvo XC70, the most ideal brand was Tesla, and the most ideal popular brand was GMC. Now, on their website, on Auto Pacific's website, and they sent out a press release, they have all the different categories. I didn't want to read all of them because there are a lot of different categories and which cars won. But it was interesting to see, GMC in there. So they got some recognition.
Well, GMC does build good vehicles, no doubt about it. They take a Chevy truck and dress it up, give it a nice suspension and some nicer touches, and it's a much nicer truck, so there's no surprise there. And if anything, General Motors, if they had half a brain sometimes, would say, yes, GMC is a truck, but it is not just a truck. It is a luxury truck experience. Because that's what they're selling, really. A GMC truck is basically a Silverado with a nicer suspension and a nicer interior.
And that's what they're doing with the Denali models, correct?
Right. Well, we've been talking a lot about technology, and FCA are paying hackers to find security bugs. So if you all are hackers, you know anything about coding, and this all started when a couple of guys hacked into a Jeep and literally took over the driving of the Jeep from the driver himself and actually drove the car off the road, even though he knew it was going to be hacked and driven off the road. He said he was still stunned when it happened to him. So what they've decided to do now is take all of these hackers and say, okay, have at it, and we'll pay you. And there's a range of payments as to, I guess, the difficulty of what the bug does and the corrective steps needed to take care of it.
I'm stretching the limit of my my computer knowledge just getting onto this show every week. that's about the total of it for me.
I was sitting in the doctor's office a little while ago, I was reading a magazine while I was waiting on my husband, and I won't mention the name of the magazine, but they had an article on autonomous cars. And there was a photograph in there that really sort of upset me because it was a picture of a guy behind the steering wheel with his hands up like this. And, you know, it's like Russ said a couple weeks ago, you wouldn't feel too good about the pilot of the airplane sitting there with their hands up like this, like they weren't ready to do something if the need arose. And personally, I found that photograph to be just a touch irresponsible, especially in light of what happened down in Florida not too long ago.
I think I know what article you're talking about, and I think they tried to explain their photo in the article, but, you know, bottom line is it was poor timing, especially when, you know, the article was released just after all that other press from that accident it had just come out. So, you know, I think I know which one you're talking about, though.
It is okay, guys, to say that the Teslas in their automatic driving mode, there's been a few accidents.
Right.
You still have to be careful.
Exactly.
No matter what.
And yeah. even though Tesla won this award from Auto Pacifica, so as the most ideal brand, and, you know, I have to commend Elon Musk. He's taken the Tesla brand, and now he's come out with his master plan. And one of the last elements of his master plan was to show you how your car can make money for you when you're not using it and it's parked. So it's going to be interesting how he explains that one. He's already moved into having battery chargers in the home as a part of the purchase price of the car. He's taken these, what do you call them, the panels that you put on your homes. They're into the panel business to generate
solar panels
to generate electricity. So he's really taken the electric car concept and made an entire full business model out of it that covers a lot of things other than just driving an autonomous car. Going back to the article, Linda, you were talking about with the hands up, it was interesting. I was watching a news report. I think they were talking about Nissan with their, what they call their ProPilot program. And they had the guy sitting behind the wheel, and the car was in ProPilot, and it was driving him. You know, it was driving him. But the guy was sitting there like this with his hands just almost touching the steering wheel. Now, can you imagine sitting for just 10 minutes with your arms outstretched and not touching the steering wheel? How much more stress and fatigue it's going to cause you if you have to sit in that position?
What they're doing, what Nissan is doing, is overcompensating for this Tesla kerfuffle over this, you know, this guy running into a tractor trailer because he wasn't paying attention. Obviously nobody's, you know, in the real world, but Nissan is in the press release they sent out for that ProPilot, which is only being put on a one model car in Japan, so it's a way off for us yet. But is they're really stressing, you know, this is just to help the driver. This isn't to take over for the driver, and the driver's got to still be engaged. And that's going to be the issue with autonomous technology anyway. At one point, it's going to be on a lot of cars where you've got a lot of this technology. I mean, I was in a Kia event, I think, for the Sportage. It's just been in the last 3 or 4 months, 5 months, and it basically itself. And so that's going to be the issue, though, is keeping drivers at least somewhat engaged and alert when they sort of turn the driving duties over to the vehicle. It's going to be a problem.
You remember about three years ago, I think it was, Audi came out with an ad where the car, you got out of the car, and it went and found its own parking place in the parking garage. I think they called it piloted parking. And, I mean, when they ran that ad, I thought, if I owned an Audi, do you think I'd trust it to park itself? You know? And maybe it's just because I'll probably be the last person alive that they'll be prying my hands off the steering wheel. But, I mean, the concept of that just blows my mind. And another thing that I think is confusing to the public is they refer to a lot of this stuff as autonomous. But if you ask Joe on the street or Mary on the street what their perception of an autonomous vehicle is, you know, it's sort of like, go back to when we were kids in a Jetson cartoon. You know, it's like, okay, you get in the back seat and, you know, I want to go to the store, and it takes you to the store and you don't have to do anything. That would be a truly autonomous vehicle that you had to do nothing. But an awful lot of what they're doing now are more like automatic features, you know, and the example I like to use is that, okay, I've got an automatic dishwasher downstairs. I've got an automatic washer downstairs. But they don't go out and collect all the dirty dishes and put them in the washing machine or the dishwasher for me. And in order for it to be an autonomous dishwasher or an autonomous washing machine, it would have to do all that. But if it just helps assist me in what I'm doing, to my way of thinking, it's an automatic dishwasher or an automatic washing machine. And a lot of these features that they're putting on vehicles now, to me, are more automatic than they are autonomous.
And that's how I like to...
Then the Volkswagen may disagree with you, because Volkswagen has just partnered with LG to develop connected cars that communicate with devices in the home and car. So that maybe that Volkswagen can talk to the robot that you have in your house to load your dishwasher and start it for you.
Right now it can start
your dishwasher. You just don't have the robot to load it. But you'll be able to control appliances in your house from your Volkswagen.
Yeah, but will it load it for me?
That's what I'm saying. You have to have that robot. You have to have that Honda robot first.
Linda doesn't need a Honda robot. She's got her husband.
And that's how I like to look at this stuff also, though, is it's assistive technology, you know? I mean, like that Infiniti that I'm in this week, it has automatic braking, and it actually works very well. It's smooth, it brakes, it leaves enough of a distance between you and the car in front of you, all that kind of stuff, but it is an assistive technology. You know, you don't just let the car go and just do its thing. You know, I mean, my foot is still right over, or at least when I was testing, it was still right over the brake pedal, and to be honest, the car would actually, it's set right now where it actually brakes a little earlier than what I typically break. So, you know, that was how I first even realized that the technology was on the car when I first got it. It was like, oh, the car is telling me to slow down. Oh, okay, I got this, you know. But the individual technologies, they're getting there. They're getting there, but the sum of the entire system itself isn't there yet. And,
right.
and again, with the terminology of autonomous being used for a lot of different things, it is giving people the wrong idea, the wrong impression that they can literally put their hands in the air or recline the seat back and close their eyes for a few minutes and let the car do its thing. It's not there yet.
Yeah, some of the safety organizations now are trying to get these car companies to change some of the terminology that they're using, because they are giving the buying public false, you know, terms in terms of what the car can actually do. It's like autonomous or driverless cars. They're trying to get them to drop those terms because, like you said, Chris, the car doesn't drive itself. Only parts of the car does certain things, and a lot of people don't know what those parts will do. Of the new car that they buy, they don't know exactly what part is autonomous or will do things without your having to do anything other than set it. And we're in and out of cars all the time, so we have a good understanding of what features will work automatically and which ones can be turned on and off. But like the braking thing, I always go back to when I had a Jag years ago, one of the press cars, and it had adaptive cruise, and a part of adaptive cruise is that braking. And a guy pulled in front of me, and the car did a hard brake and scared me to death. I thought I had done something. I literally pulled off the road to try and find what was wrong with the car until I saw an icon on the dashboard that pretty much explained that, oh, this has adaptive cruise, and it was set at a close distance to the car in front of you. So, yeah, this whole thing about autonomous cars, it's getting a lot of print. It's getting a lot of airtime. And I think it's just confusing the car-buying public more and more and more. Every time they put out a picture with a guy sitting there with his hands up, or they put out a picture of with a crashed car and you have people being killed, it's not helping what they're trying to do in the marketplace. So,
and that's what it is. It's right now, it's still just marketing.
Right.
Autonomous cars and G-vectoring.
On that note, we'll G-vector right out of here. I want to thank the panel for taking the time to hang around for an hour, give their positive and insightful input while in the news topics. And this is Roosevelt with Auto Network Reports. And as always, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. Please buckle up. Don't text and drive. See you next Thursday, same time.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.